I just want to thank everybody for coming out. I know Tuesday night, everybody's busy, everybody's got work, everybody's got plans, but obviously this is an important thing. We're getting ready to try to elect a sheriff, obviously here in Fulton County, and the ideal is to elect a Republican sheriff in Fulton County. Just for those of you guys that don't know, my name is Nate Porter. I'm the president of the Fulton County Republican Assembly. We just recently chartered here. When did we charter? It's been about 2 months in January, so we're a new organization. Just so you guys know a little bit about what kind of our goals and our objectives are, what we're trying to do is get more people involved in Republican politics, try to be kind of like that introduction to get more people involved in the party. So I strongly encourage everybody here to join the Republican Party. Make sure you guys join your local, not just the state party, not just the national party, but make sure that you guys are also joining your local parties. We have a great Fulton County Republican Party that I encourage everybody here to get involved in. Trey Kelly's the chairman. We got our website, FultonGOP.com. We invite all of you guys to come out and check it out.
.org.
Thank you. And Suzie back there is, she's in charge of sending out all the emails. She gets everything back. We just want to start off, obviously, with the Pledge of Allegiance. So if I can have Nick come on up really quick. And the flag's in the back corner, so if everyone wants to stand.
Please place your right hands over your hearts. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Nick. And right now, if we could have Dave come on up. Dave's going to do the invocation.
Thank you, Nate. As I was thinking about this event, I thought it'd be interesting to consider what God's plan is for the governance of man and also his ideal for the implementation of justice. So my thoughts, I was reading through Exodus 13, verses 18 through 25. And in this, it describes how Moses led the people of Israel, which numbered about 3 million, out of Egypt. And one of the things that is interesting is the form of governance that they had, which was God spoke directly to Moses, of course. He gave Moses the Bible, the Ten Commandments, excuse me. And God also spoke directly to other leaders of the nation of Israel, or the people of Israel. That there was no hierarchical government at that time. It was this loose, more confederation that was typical of the tribes of the area at that time. In addition, Moses decided disputes between the people. Now this took him, it was an enormous task, and his son-in-law recognized that this was too much work for one person, so he suggested that Moses set up a hierarchy of judges, with Moses being the supreme judge, and then this filtering down to the lower level to have other people settle more minor disputes. So this is the governance and the implementation of justice that God had planned for Israel. Now the Israel people looked around and they saw the opulence of the kings of the other nations, and they desired this for their own because they didn't have one. So despite this not being the plan, or God's plan, this was granted, and Israel became ruled by kings. The results of that were actually disastrous, because what came with the power of the kingdom and the king also came with the corruption, which ultimately undermined the society and led to the destruction of the nations of Israel. I was reading this weekend a quote from Rand Paul, in which he said that government is a necessary evil. And as I read those scriptures, I thought it might be more accurate to say that, to leave out the qualifying word necessary. So That's my understanding of what I read. So now we're going to talk about the sheriff's office, and the sheriff is actually our last line of defense for the Constitution. We'll learn more about that. That's what the purpose of the forum is tonight. So if I can lead everybody in an invocation briefly. Dear Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for all of the candidates who have the courage and desire to come forth and be leaders in the area. We ask that your wisdom and judgment be on them so that they can govern when elected with integrity and honor. We ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen.
For those of you guys that don't know, the Fulton Republican Assembly is not just a local thing. It's actually part of the Georgia Republican Assembly. So right now what I'd like to do is invite up our chairman, Alex Johnson, to explain a little bit more about the Georgia Republican Assembly.
Yep. Everyone, for those who don't know me, I'm Alex Johnson. I'm the president of the Georgia Republican Assembly. The Georgia Republican Assembly is the state chapter of part of the National Federation of Republican Assemblies. The National Federation has been around since the 30s. We're called the Republican Wing of the Republican Party. So part of that is just figuring out what that means. And what that comes down to is that throughout the history of the Republican Party, there have been a lot of groups or people who may not have been in it for the right reasons. They may have been in it for political power. They may have been in it because they wanted to make money off politics instead of actually standing up for the principles that lead to good government. And that's why the National Federation is committed to the idea of being the Republican wing of the Republican Party. We actually have a set of principles. They're on the sheets of paper I know that Nate's been handing out around the room and are on our website that actually show the principles of philosophy that define us. And in all honesty, they're what define just about all Republicans. They're the general values and principles that lead to a better government, that lead to individuals being able to succeed in society and those individual rights that we all have and be able to succeed with less government, lower taxes, and just traditional values. The Georgia chapter was founded a few years back. I was elected president a few months ago. Since that time, we've started two local chapters. We're about to start at least two more. We have close to 100 people around the state, and it's growing daily. I'd encourage anyone in this room who is against corporate cronyism and believes in a stronger, more vibrant party where people are empowered to get involved. Because on the state level, what we're focused on is being a one-stop shop for political empowerment. So that when people from the public who believe in our principles want to be involved and cause an impact in politics, they have the opportunity. Like tonight, you have the opportunity to hear from people running for public office. That's something that a lot of people don't do face-to-face. You ask people questions. You can get to know candidates for public office if you agree with them or not and have that dialogue. Additionally, we're going to let people know how to run for political office, how to run for party office. Personally, I've run for chairman of the state Republican Party twice. Almost got it last time, might try again. But in the end, that's what it's about, is letting people know how to be the delegates to the National Convention. Letting people know how to cause an impact in politics. And Nate Porter here and the rest of the Fulton Republican Assembly has done a great job in growing in Fulton. It's just going to get bigger. So I encourage all of you to go to georgiara.com and get involved. Also, feel free to talk to me or Nate or anybody else wearing one of these name badges and just ask about the assembly, because that's how you know their numbers. And please get involved. If you have any doubts or questions, please reach out to me. We will be endorsing convention on Sunday in the next couple weeks for some offices in Fulton or DeKalb County. So thank you all. And look forward to hearing from all the sheriffs.
Thank you, Alex. And anybody that's interested in joining, back over there where Denise is at, if you could raise your hand. We have forums where you guys can fill out. You can sign up today if you guys would like, or you can go to the website like Alex said. The nice thing about the membership is it's $45 for an individual, and that's a lifetime membership, so it's not like an annual thing, and you get one of these cool name badges. Pretty much seals the deal for everybody. If you are a family, you have a wife or a significant other, you can get a family membership. It's $80. You get a $5 discount on each of yours. And again, you get the fancy name badges. So we have other levels as well. If you have some deep pockets and really want to get involved, we are not going to say no. You're more than welcome to contribute whatever you guys want to. The next thing that we want to get to is we have several individuals that are running for office. One of the things that Alex mentioned is that the, actually before that, I'm sorry, we have some other organizations that are kind of like sister organizations or brother organizations. So I want to give an opportunity for a couple of people to come up. First, can I get James Edwards, please? James is going to talk about the Buckhead Freedom Coalition.
I just wanted to invite everyone this Thursday to a meeting of the Buckhead Freedom Coalition at the Buckhead branch of the Fulton Atlanta Public Library. We're going to meet at 6 o'clock to 7:30, followed by fellowship and refreshments at the Fidel Irish Pub across the street. The Buckhead Freedom Coalition is a grassroots organization dedicated to limited government, religious liberty, protection of human life, tax simplification, a strong national defense, school choice, and local control of health, education, welfare, morals, and community standards. So that seems to be enough to focus on. And we network with like-minded organizations like this one who want to reform and rebrand and revitalize the Georgia GOP. So I just want to invite all of you to, if you can, to attend this Thursday at 6 o'clock at the Buckhead branch of the library on Buckhead Avenue. That's where the new Beverly Hills or Rodeo Drive over Atlanta is located, there on Buckhead Avenue, off right off of Peachtree Road. And thank you all for coming, and looking forward to finding out more about the importance of the position of sheriff tonight. Thank you.
Thank you, James. Next I want to bring up is the founder of the Hispanic Patriots, Dahlys.
Yeah.
She has a bum leg, so bear with her.
Like a Star Wars movie. It looks worse than it is. I'm Dallas Hamilton. I'm the founder of Hispanic Patriots. Until a few days ago, I was the founder and chair, but we just brought on a new chairman and an executive director. We are a group of conservative Hispanics. I'm about as far right as you can get, and I felt like that voice was not being heard here in Atlanta or in the United States. There's not a conservative Hispanic organization anywhere in the United States. There are some that call themselves conservative, but when you look at their website, they're really not conservative. So right now we're meeting up in Gwinnett. We have monthly meetings, and we're going to start chapters all over Atlanta and Georgia and then the United States. It's a lot to do, but we're working on a business plan right now. We almost have that wrapped up. And I'm also the, fact that I haven't even announced this publicly yet. We have any Trump fans here? No Trump fans. Okay, well, you probably don't like me. You got one? Okay. I was just asked to be an advisor on the National Diversity Coalition for Trump. And so I will be flying up there to meet with Donald Trump on Monday in New York at Trump Towers. So if you're a Trump fan, come talk to me. And our website is HispanicPatriots.org. We're also on Facebook. Thank you.
Next, one of the things that Alex talked about was getting people more involved in actually running for office. And what we want to do is, as a grassroots organization specifically focused in Fulton County, is we want to try to constantly give anybody that is running for office as a Republican in Fulton County an opportunity to speak and say a few words and really kind of try to get their name out there, trying to make the primaries a little bit more competitive. So with that said, I'd like to invite a couple people that are running for office. The first I'd like to introduce is Susan Voyles.
Golly, the only time somebody calls me Susan is when I've done something naughty and I'm not going to call them. Most people know me as Suzie, and not only pleased to be here, I'm very proud to be here. I love Sandy Springs. I'm running for the vacated 3rd District City Council seat, and if anybody here is from Sandy Springs, I would not only love to talk to you. We need some fresh, independent thinking for the challenges that are about to meet our city, and I know that this is a one-minute little speech, so I just can't thank you enough for being here, for being interested in what you're doing. And if you live in the 3rd District in Sandy Springs, vote Suzie.
Next up, we have somebody that's running for State House, Catherine Bernard.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Catherine Bernard. I'm running for House District 80 State Representative. We've got the Republican primary coming up on May 24th. And House District 80, we are actually right outside of it right now. It covers part of Fulton and a big chunk of DeKalb, Brookhaven, and Chamblee. So if you go to friendsofcatherinebernard.org, you can look at our great Google map and see our weirdly shaped district and which of your friends live inside of it. I'm running because we really need some independent-minded Republican representations in the House. We used to have a supermajority in the House of Representatives here in Georgia, and we lost that because of the House District 80 special election last summer. It's a little bit of a heartbreaker. I came up short of the runoff by 56 votes, but it really showed people that, you know, the Republican label isn't necessarily what matters anymore. It's the Republican ideas of limited government, lower taxes, personal responsibility, and just common sense. You know, don't spend more than we have. Don't overdevelop and give us more congestion. Don't subsidize the people who don't need subsidies. These are some common sense Republican views and principles that we can stand for. And so I'm very excited that we have so many folks out here tonight showing up for the Republican Assembly. Very excited to hear from the sheriff's candidates, so I might duck out to do a little bit of door knocking. And just, I would encourage everyone to think about not just talking to other Republicans about our ideas, but reach out to independents, reach out to Democrats. There are a lot of people out there who believe in personal responsibility and small government. We just haven't messaged it right yet. So I love that we're having this conversation. I love everything that y'all are doing here in Fulton County. And I would encourage you, if you are in this part of Sandy Springs, Brookhaven or Chamblee, to please vote Catherine Bernard on May 24th. So thank you so much for your time.
Thank you, Catherine. We also, for those of you guys that don't know, going back on what Alex said, one of the goals of this is to get people to understand how the Republican Party works a little bit more, and to understand how to get involved in the Republican Party. And one of the things that we do every 4 years, generally around presidential election time, is there's an election for committeeman, committeewoman of the Republican Party. These are your representatives on the RNC, the Republican National Committee. And we have a candidate right now, Maria Zack, who is running for committeewoman.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you so much for what you're doing, for taking time out of your personal lives, coming and working to make our country better. And I just cannot thank you enough for being spirited enough. Please tell me you support the Constitution. Thank you. Washington, and I'm very afraid I'm in a different country. So I know what's back home, and I know it's you guys. It's our families. It's everything that it takes to live our lives rich with God first and everything else second. And I have to tell you, my sixth great grandfather penned the Declaration of Independence. It was bred in us that this country is the most important country that we have to protect, those ideals that our forefathers brought to this country. And they were brilliant. It is not the time to go monkeying with a system that is just crazy what the left is proposing. We have to stop the creep and the slavery that they are putting us in. The bondage of our debt is outrageous. We have to stop looking at giving welfare at the level that we give it. We have to stop the fraud, waste, and abuse, because the real poor don't get it. We have to be able to give solutions at the state level. And I know y'all are kind of learning about the Republican Party, but I will tell you, the Republican Party and the Democratic Party have betrayed us. They have not followed the Constitution. The roadmap is very clear, very simple. And so I, as National Committeewoman, will pledge to you, as the Republican Assembly, that I will come anytime Alex or Nate or anyone else asks me to. I will keep you up to date on what is happening with the Platform Committee, the Rules Committee. I think it's important for y'all to know what the Republican Party stands for. And if I have my voice heard, which I haven't had a real problem with having happen, I can tell you they're going to hear loud and clear, limited government, less regulation, lower taxes, and by God, the Constitution comes first. God bless you. Thank you for having me.
Thank you. Last, but certainly not least, we have a candidate that's running for Senate, Derrick, Grayson.
Good evening, everyone. Some of the things I'm going to say are going to be probably ugly, but easy to say. This is pocket constitution. You ask the average person which part or the Bill of Rights, they can't tell you. I went to a couple of events the other night that were bipartisan, Republicans and Democrats, in one place. There were at least 100 people in the room. And I made it plain I am for the Constitution, the Bill of Rights, limited government, obeying the Constitution, and preserving the Bill of Rights, and fighting to limit government. I ask, raise your hands if those things are important to you. Less, I'm not asking you to. Less than half the people in that room raised their hands. Less than half. That doesn't happen when I go to a room where it's just a bunch of Republicans. Most everybody in that room raises their hand. But here's the disconnect. Liberals, Democrats, understand that they don't give a damn about the Constitution. That's already clear with them. They're progressives. But on the other hand, Republicans claim they want those things, but they continue to re-elect people who violate the Constitution over and over and over again. I stood with Alex when he ran for chair twice. And I watched how people just refused to let go of the undeniable, the verifiable, and the documented corruption of the Georgia GOP. The Georgia GOP offered me money to drop out of the race in 2014 to instead run against Hank Johnson, a race that they knew I wouldn't win because of how it was stacked with Democrats and the way they drew the lines. But yet we claim we want limited government. We claim we want the Constitution preserved. We claim we believe in the Bill of Rights, but we will go right back out and vote for people like Johnny Isaacson, who has undocumented, verifiable, and undeniable proof that he has done things to violate the Constitution, your Bill of Rights, and the expansion of government. So what am I saying to you? Why am I running? I don't want to run. I got five daughters. I'm running for them and your children. I would rather be at home with them, but I'm willing to give up all that I am and all that I have to fight for their lives and their futures and the futures of your children. But I can't go if you don't send me. I can't go if you aren't brave enough to do something different. One thing about it, the Democrats, while they are solid in what they believe in, the base in the Democrat, in the Democratic Party really want what's right. And the Republicans, the base, while we are divided, we got Trumpers, we got cruisers, you know, you've seen what's been going on. We say we want those other things. But the only way we're going to get them is if we stand up and are willing to do what is right. Make no mistake about it. Only we can change Washington, D.C. because the power belongs to the people. not those in Washington, D.C. The people in Washington, D.C. did not end slavery. They did not end Jim Crow. The ones that ended it were the people of America who said enough is enough. They made them get rid of slavery. They made them get rid of Jim Crow. We have to make the Republican Party what I call the Royals. We have to make them take a back seat, and we have to make the people in D.C. understand that the power belongs to us, we the people, and we don't need leaders. I'm not going to be your leader. No one has ever heard me say, I will be the kind of leader that will do this or do that, because I don't want to be your leader. I'm only going so that I can serve according to the Constitution. The last thing I want to say, don't shut up. I use biblical examples also. Jesus wanted to wash the feet of his disciples. And Peter said, no, you will never wash my feet. And Jesus said, then I will have no part of you. Our representatives have forgotten what it's about. They go to serve, not lead. Thank you.
There's two individuals I actually neglected to mention, so we're going to go back to those two really quick. The first is Nick, who's going to tell us about his organization.
Hello, folks. For those who don't know me, I am Nick Cooper. I am the, in addition to being involved with the Georgia Republican Assembly, I am also the chairman of the Atlanta chapter of America's Future Foundation, and which is the premier network for young, liberty-minded young professionals across the country. So I just wanted to let you guys know about an event we have coming up next, or actually on the 26th, which is two Tuesdays from now, over at the Hudson Grill in Midtown. It is a book forum on the Conservatarian Manifesto, which is a book written by Charles C.W. Cook, a writer from the National Review. And he'll also have two co-panelists, both Monica Perez from WSB and Greg Williams, who leads a radio show on America's Web Radio, which many of you guys might know from a lot of the other Republican functions. So if you guys can, come on out, join us, and let's have a lot of fun. Thank you.
Now we have, who's actually running in this House District right here, we have Graham McDonald running for House District 58.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Graham McDonald, and as Nathan said, I'm running for House District 52, which includes this very restaurant. I live about 2 miles in that direction. I have a long history of being extremely committed and invested in this community until I qualified for this race 4 or so weeks ago. I served the community as Sandy Springs City Councilman for over 2 years in the position that Suzie is now running for. My children go to preschool about a quarter of a mile in that direction at Sandy Springs United Methodist Church. My family worships at Holy Innocence Episcopal Church, about 2 miles in that direction. I'm a lawyer by trade. I own a law firm. We do business law right here in this community. I care deeply about the community, and I'm looking to serve it from the State House and protect the great quality of life we have here and govern with conservative principles. Thank you.
One more announcement before we get to tonight's main event. In the back there, right where Denise is at, there is a petition. For those of you guys that haven't seen the petition yet, it's a petition to the Fulton County Board of Commissioners opposing the referendum pertaining to SB 369. For those of you guys that don't know, a few years ago there was this huge T-SPLOS, this huge tax increase that they were trying to push down the local voters that got overwhelmingly denied, got rejected by the voters. But they've just relentlessly tried to bring that exact same tax back again and again and again. And I'm not gonna, in the essence of time, I'm not gonna go ahead and read the whole thing, but there is a petition back there. For those of you guys that are opposed to a tax increase after we just had a $1 billion tax increase that was supposedly meant to go to bridges and roads and, you know, transportation issues, I strongly urge you to sign this petition. When you say that, Last thing I want to do is I just kind of want to briefly go over the sheriff, the responsibilities and the role. You know, I'll be honest with you, the sheriff is kind of one of those offices that I'm sure a lot of us don't really pay a whole lot of attention to. Probably don't really know a whole lot about, which is why I'm excited to get an opportunity to listen to two candidates actually inform us and tell us a little bit more. But the history of the sheriff kind of goes back all the way to the Magna Carta, where essentially the sheriffs, their whole role and their whole responsibility is to stand up to the king when the king is being unjust, just to simplify it. So that tradition is essentially carried on into our U.S. tradition, and the sheriff is essentially the head of their jurisdiction. They are the supreme authority in the land area that their county represents. And it is their responsibility, it is their duty to uphold the Constitution, which means that they're supposed to be our last line of defense, or first line of defense, when the federal government is overstepping its bounds and they're stepping outside the Constitution. So it's actually probably one of the most important roles in any given county, if not the most important role in a county. So I'm really excited about the two candidates that we have here today. And with that said, I'm going to go ahead and turn it over to John, and John's going to introduce the candidates.
Hi everyone, my name is John Ferros. I'm one of the officers at the Fulton Republican Assembly. So I want to thank you all for our outing. This is a big event right now. We're going to be talking to the sheriffs and having questions for them. Very important. This is really your forum. So do you have questions? If you have questions, please fill out an index card. We have index cards in the back on the table and provide them to Nick. Nick, will you please stand up and raise your hand? Nick is the person who's collecting the questions. And again, if there aren't any questions, we really don't have much of a forum. So it's really important to do that, please. A couple other things real quick. There's some great material that we also have back at our table. This red book is Georgia Sunshine Laws, and this blue book is Georgia Law Enforcement and the Open Records Act. It's really important to know your rights, to know the laws, and know what kind of rights you have with respect to, again, getting records and having transparent government. So the way it's going to work this evening is, again, we're collecting questions from the crowd. Please have questions. If you don't have questions, this is not going to be very informative for you. We have some questions here at the FRA that we're going to ask our candidates as well. One quick thing is I'm going to give one quick plug for the FRA again. Everyone has talked about how great the organization is, and it is. And the reason it's so great is because it is truly a grassroots organization. We're small, we're growing, and whatever your passion is, then you have an opportunity to make it happen. Let's just say your passion is the Second Amendment. Join us. Start a committee to get your word out, to get the understanding to the community of what it means to have Second Amendment rights. Whatever your passion is, here's a place to do it. So I encourage you again to join the GRA. Something that someone didn't mention, you can join for as little as $10. That's all it costs for a year. Give us a try. I think you're going to really enjoy what you see, what you get out of it. Okay, so now it's time to bring our candidates, Mr. Coward and Mr. Green. If I could ask you to come up here and just sit right here real quickly. Just give a hand. We had a coin toss earlier in terms of who would go first. So the way this is going to work is we're going to ask each of our candidates to give an opening statement, and then we'll have questions. So the person who won the coin toss to go first was Mr. Green. Mr. Green has over 30 years in law enforcement and military experience, and he's completed two missions in Afghanistan as an international police officer. Sheriff Green is prepared to lead Fulton County as its sheriff. Please give a big hand for Mr. Green.
Good evening. First of all, I'd like to thank the organizers for allowing this platform to come and stand before the people to say a little bit about what the sheriff really does. Like you said, my name is Sheriff Green. A little bit about me. I'm a military resident, former John Creek resident, and I brought my wife with me, Roland. We have three children. I'm a former Georgia State Trooper, and my desire to be sheriff is based on 30 plus years of being involved in serving people. Law enforcement is law enforcement, but you can't enforce laws, you can't protect people if you don't have a heart for serving people. So being sheriff and wanting to be sheriff is based on that experience. Being a Georgia State Trooper, also have been a Fulton County Deputy Sheriff, a Calumet County Deputy Sheriff, and also a Fulton County School Police Officer. The reason I want to be sheriff is it's time out for this particular office to be a political role. It's time out for this department having a department head that only serves to pad his retirement. And that's what's going on. Based on my years of experience in Fulton County, 25 plus years in the metro Atlanta area, serving the people, that's what I want to bring to this particular office. So I want everyone to consider supporting me, consider making a change. This particular position, we have nearly 1 million citizens in this county. And the last sheriff race has only produced about 50,000 voters. So there's an apathy for this particular position. Not because this particular position isn't important. Being sheriff in the state of Georgia, this is a Georgia constitutionally mandated position. A Georgia sheriff is the highest ranking law enforcement official in the state. Not the federal government, not the Georgia State Patrol, but the sheriff of the county. It's time for this county to have a sheriff that can lead the county, that can go out front as a servant. And not only that, but have experience. I'm that person. Support me. I love to talk with you. I'm Sharon Green. We also have early voting from May the 2nd until May the 13th. And our primary voting is May the 24th. God bless you. God bless America.
Thank you, Mr. Green. Our next candidate is Mr. Ben Coward. Mr. Coward is a lifelong Atlanta native. He's a third-generation Fulton County resident. He has been a reserve deputy for approximately 5 years in Fulton County and approximately another 4 years in Gwinnett for a grand total of almost 9 years of service as a reserve deputy. Now, mind you, this reserve deputy position is all volunteer, so that gives you an idea of what he's been doing. And Mr. Coward is also a Johns Creek resident. Please. Round of applause for Mr. Ben Howard.
First of all, I'd like to thank y'all for coming out tonight. This is probably boring for most people because most people don't even know who the sheriff is. Our current sheriff is pretty, how do you say? He's invisible. Nobody knows who he is. And most people don't even know what the sheriff's department does. I've got 9 years experience as a reserve deputy. That's kind of, most people don't know what that is. That means I volunteered my time and worked at the sheriff's department for free. While I wasn't working there, I was working myself in the real estate business and building houses. And I also have a military equipment business. I have resold military equipment that I bought from the military. I've lived in this town all my life. I love it here. If I didn't have so many friends here still, though, I'd probably move. Because I look around and I don't like what I see happening on the south side of the county. And the problem's growing and nobody's looking at it. We've got a heroin problem on the north side, home invasion problem on the south side, and there's no leadership in the sheriff's department. Sheriff is the highest ranking officer in the county, and he is supposed to stand up for you, and he's not doing it. My opponent is very qualified, and he's taller than I am, too. I really do love this town, and I don't want to move. Anyway, we've got to beat the Democrats. We've never had a Republican sheriff in Fulton County. What's going on in Washington? We're watching the national politics. It's a scandal. It's just crazy what we see going on these days. And, you know, we've got to do better. I appreciate your vote.
Thank you, gentlemen. We're going to go right into the questions. We're going to start with questions from the audience. We have quite a few, so thank you very much. We're going to just ask you questions, and then we'll alternate. So this question is for you, Mr. Green. What is the biggest shortcoming of the current office holder, and how are you going to fix this or improve any problem? The biggest shortcoming of the current office holder, and how are you going to fix this?
Again, having to work in this county and dedicated nearly half of my life to Fulton County and the people in Fulton County, this particular office has really come way short in serving the people. I don't have anything negative to say about Ted Jackson. I mean, that's not why I'm here. But if you're going to serve the people, you serve all the people, whether they're in East Point or Jones Creek or Chattahoochee Hills. But I want to make one thing clear when you start talking about the Fulton County Sheriff's Department. The Fulton County Sheriff's Department, it is not a full service law enforcement agency, which means that the Fulton County Sheriff's Department does not have a patrol division where they're actively answering calls. The main three things that the Fulton County Sheriff's Department does, they take care of the jail, they secure the courthouse, and they serve warrants. That's the Fulton County Sheriff's Department. Now, when you have a sheriff that does not have a vision to want to do those things or interact with the citizens of the county to know what they would want, a lot of things are going to fall short. If you're the county sheriff that is not involving itself with people all over the county, just getting in and just going along and get along is going to probably be what you get. And having worked in this county for over 25 years, I have an inside look, not only from being in Fulton County as a deputy, but operating and serving the people of Fulton County and Metro Atlanta as a Georgia State Trooper. The Fulton County Sheriff's Department needs a change. One of the biggest shortcomings based on what they're doing now is the Fulton County Sheriff's Department needs a level of professionalism. The Fulton County Sheriff's Department needs a level of integrity, and the Fulton County Sheriff's Department needs to have people in place to do that. When you're watching television, you're a county resident, and you see one of the command staff on the present administration being caught up in a prostitution sting in a neighboring county, that's a problem. That's a problem. When you're watching television and you're seeing that our jail has cell phones in the jail and everything else, that's a problem. When people are dying in that jail, that's a problem. When we have over 20,000 outstanding warrants with dangerous people walking around the street that should be behind bars, that's a problem. When you have a sheriff that does not get involved in the judicial process, that has a relationship with the lawmakers and the judges to say, hey, let's keep the violent offenders inside of the jail, and let's have some type of criminal interdiction as far as those people that have less violent offenses, let's get them out of jail. The last two police officers, that law enforcement officers that have been killed in the metro area was killed by people that had a rap sheet that had been in and out of jail. So it's not just one problem. If I have the time, I could go about 30 more minutes with not so much the problem, but what we need to do to change it so our sheriff department can be a sheriff department that our citizens feel proud to say, hey, that's Sheriff Green, and he's doing something, and I can call him anytime. I can go to his office anytime. He's not only working, but wow, he wears the uniform. And he gets out there with his deputies and get after it. That's the kind of sheriff I'm going to be if elected. And I implore you and I ask you to support me. If you have any questions, if you have any ideas, let me know. Because I promise you, I'll give you all I got with the 30 plus years of experience that the good Lord has allowed me to have and to gather. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Green. I'll ask the same question to you, Mr. Coward. What is the biggest shortcoming of the current office holder, and how are you going to improve this?
Well, some of you may know, we had a consent decree from the federal courts to decrease the population of the jail. And we did the sheriff did this partially by taking over the Union City Jail, and we had moved the ladies over there, and we're just below maximum population now. But at the same time, back when we were working with the Sheriff's Department, we had 15 cars on the road serving warrants, three shifts a day. We only have two working part-time today. So have we eased the population problem at the jail just by not arresting anybody? That doesn't sound like a good solution to me. And I heard the numbers that I heard, and I have not confirmed this yet, but somebody ought to file an Open Records Act request and find out how many warrants there are out there, because the number I heard was closer to 100,000. The population of the county is only 1 million. That means 1 in 10. So that to me is the biggest problem.
Thank you. In the interest of time, we're going to ask the candidates to restrict their responses to 2 minutes. Mr. Coward, now this is back to you. Mr. Coward, this question is for you. How do you plan to stop contraband from getting into the jail?
Well, we should have a squad that searches people inside the jail and shakes them down as they're walking around. You're transporting a prisoner. You have a crew that all they do is go throughout the jail stopping people as they're moving around and searching them. And that's how you catch them, because you can't really hide a whole lot in these jumpsuits we have. But we got to find out how it's getting into the jail. We need to get our employees to take more lie detector tests, because that's it's got to be coming in somehow. You know, we just, cell phone thing, it's possible to wire the building where the cell phones won't work in there. Now, it's against federal rules, but I think it's something we ought to look at.
Mr. Grayson, same question for you. How do you plan to stop contraband from getting into the jail?
Thank you. Contraband, anything that shouldn't be in the jail is considered contraband, whether it be food, knives, cell phones, or whatever, you know, that's contraband. And the only way we solve that is you got to have people with integrity. And when you do that, a lot of that will stop. The only way those inmates are getting phones and getting on YouTube, making movies, and getting on Facebook is because the deputies are bringing that contraband into the jail. How do you stop it? You know, you have to vet your people. You have to vet your people. I don't care what organization it is, whether it's a law enforcement organization or IBM, you're only gonna be as good as your people. So, it's going to be a very tough job, a doable job. You have to get in there and clean that jail out. You have to clean the jail out. You have to hold your deputies to a higher standard. This position right here as a law enforcement officer, you have to be held to a higher standard. If you don't have standards, get just what we have in the Fulton County Jail.
Next question for you, Mr. Green, is what do you know about interposition and blocking federal overreach? Please explain your understanding of this concept. What do you know about interposition and blocking federal overreach? Please explain your understanding of this concept.
I don't know who asked the question. I have absolutely no knowledge. I don't know what that is. If somebody, whoever asked the question, if they can explain it, maybe if you came at another angle, but from being the sheriff and law enforcement, that's my first time you can ever hear that term. So help me out if you can.
Who asked the question? Can we have somebody?
Interposition is where a sheriff stands in between the federal authorities and the citizens of their county.
Basically, whether interposition being the sheriff standing between them and the federal government, or the sheriff standing between anybody, the sheriff is based and supported on two things: the Constitution of this great state and this great country, and the sheriff stands on post. Police officers stand in training and counsel. That's our guideline. If somebody tries to get between that, the sheriff has the authority. If we want to start talking about that, and we say the Second Amendment, if the federal government tried to come in and try to do anything, I would have that authority to go no, because I could stand on the Constitution. But anything else that, whatever goes on as sheriff, that's my authority, and that would be my position to protect and stand for the people in Fulton County, in any county, in any person, as far as that's concerned.
Mr. Coward, same question for you. What do you know about interposition and blocking federal overreach? Please explain your understanding of this concept.
I can think of one example that I think we all saw play out on nationwide TV. The incident in Waco, Texas, when they tried to arrest Mr. Koresh. The sheriff in that county was friends with him. If they really wanted to arrest him, all they'd have to do is get out there one morning when he was jogging, and he jogged every day. And we all saw what happened, and we saw the fire, and we saw who started it. If I was sheriff of that county, I would have charged him with murder.
You again, and the next question is for you. How do you feel about civil asset forfeiture when the person is not charged with a crime?
I don't like it at all. If you run across a truckload of drugs and there's some money in it, I'm okay with that. But as far as just arresting a citizen who's traveling through your county and he has to have a lot of cash on him, I don't have a problem with that. It's his money.
Same question for you. How do you feel about civil asset forfeiture when the person is not charged with a crime?
I don't have a personal opinion. The law requires and allows certain things. If you have an individual traveling on the interstate and he has X amount of cash, no one has the right just to take it. It has to fall under a certain statute, so to speak. You just can't. That's a pretty broad-based question. If drugs are involved, the amount of cash that's involved, but just saying, just taking somebody's property and not being arrested, well, you don't even have probable cause. Yes, sir.
I asked that question. He did too. That's why I clarified what he said. Mm-hmm. Let's say drugs are not. Let's say I'm traveling with $20,000. As a sheriff's deputy or a policeman or anyone else have a right just to confiscate my money?
No, sir.
Just because they pulled me over for speed.
No, sir, but you're talking to a law enforcement guy here. I would ask, what did he stop me for? We can go on and on. Why did he stop me? He has to have a reason.
any law enforcement officer that stops you or says anything to you has to have probable cause. Without that, it's an illegal stop.
Let's say I was speeding. Because this has happened all across the country where someone gets stopped for speeding, they have cash on them and it gets confiscated.
Well, normally, sir, I've stopped a lot of speeders. When you stop them for speeding, you're not searching cars. So, you know, to go into that mindset, I've been in the mindset that I've been in for over 25 years. That's just not procedurally correct.
Okay.
Nope.
Hold on. As sheriff, will you encourage lawful open carry, or are you for more gun control restrictions? And how will you accomplish this?
As sheriff, and I'm an American citizen, and I support and stand on the U.S. Constitution. That's an individual right, whether you want to exercise your Second Amendment rights. Only thing I say with the rights are is that with our constitutional rights comes responsibility. And I'll leave that to the individual citizens, whether they want to carry or not. Thank you very much.
Mr. Carroll, same question for you. As sheriff, will you encourage lawful open carry, or are you for more gun control restrictions? And how will you accomplish this?
I would not encourage open carry because it just makes some people nervous. And I think you give up a tactical advantage if you show everybody you're carrying a gun. I wouldn't be for outlawing it, but I think we should try to make our fellow citizens feel a little more at ease. Walking into the airport with an AR-15, it has happened. And I think that's crazy, but I would not be for outlawing open carry.
Mr. Cowan, what changes need to be made to reduce inmate recidivism?
I went to a forum the other day, and any of y'all know Judge Boggs? Well, he pointed out that we have the largest per capita inmate population in Georgia. The state of Georgia has the largest inmate population per capita in the country. And if you know, the United States has the largest per capita inmate population in the world. So Georgia is number one. That's not a good thing. They did a study and they found that if you could get somebody who's in jail out for 2 years and help them not reoffend and not get back in the system, chances are after 2 years, the rate falls off drastically for recidivism. So we've got to do something when we get somebody out on parole. We've got to keep up with these people, help them find a place to live, help them find jobs, and get back into society as a productive member. If we don't, they'll be back. And Georgia will still be number one.
Mr. Green, same question for you. What changes need to be made to reduce inmate recidivism?
Folks, we can build jails and we can lock people up forever and ever in this criminal justice process. As sheriff, one of the things I would like to do to help solve this problem is we have to get into the communities. We have to be an active member in the community with our children. We have to be more community-oriented to stop a lot of the things that's going on. Like I said, the last two law enforcement officers that were killed by people that should have been in jail. Okay. if we get into these communities and be more visible, to be more impactful in our communities, I believe we can help. And I believe we can start to turn things around. But this problem we're having in Georgia, we're having it all across the country. Our economy has a lot to do with it. The jail is about at its capacity, but we have to understand the jail is at its capacity, but when that jail was built, Atlanta was a lot smaller community. We're growing. We're getting offenders from other parts of the country. So that's a big issue. But law enforcement's job has to be more than about locking people up. We got to get into the communities, we got to create programs, and we got to be a more integral part of our young people's lives and our communities, especially in Fulton County.
Next question is from Mr. Green. How will you prioritize violent and property crimes versus nonviolent drug crimes?
Folks, again, the Fulton County Sheriff's Department is not a full-service sheriff's department. Gwinnett County is a full-service sheriff's department. Coweta County is a full-service sheriff's department. Clayton County is not a full-service sheriff's department. Cherokee County is a full-service sheriff's department. Where I'm getting at is the responsibilities of the Fulton County Sheriff's Department, we're in the jail. We're in the courts, and we're serving warrants. That's what we do. We're not out in the communities patrolling to be able to make or be involved in some of those things. So as sheriff, and if elected as sheriff, those are the only things I want to focus on. But don't get me wrong. As sheriff, we have the right and the ability to be involved. But Atlanta, we have many, many jurisdictions within Fulton County. And I think as sheriff, you have to allow those other jurisdictions to do what they do, whether it's East Point or Atlanta, Sandy Springs or Johns Creek. And if we can be an assistant agency, that's what we want to do. But our hands are tied with running the jail. That jail is the heartbeat of this county. Our hands are tied with being downtown, securing the courts. And we're so far behind. We're years behind in serving warrants. And the only thing I'm saying now is the responsibility where the sheriff is now, we have to clean that up. We have to clean that up before we start extending ourselves into other facets of law enforcement. Law enforcement is not just the sheriff department's responsibility. It's every community, every agency within the county. We have to work together.
Mr. Coward, same question for you. How will you prioritize violent and property crimes versus nonviolent drug crimes?
Violent offenders need to be in the jail, and I think nonviolent drug offenders need to be in a program.
Would you support reforms of the drug war? Specifically, would you prefer that cannabis is legalized so you can allocate finite police resources to more pertinent matters?
I've been asked that question a number of times. I don't really know the answer to that question. I know they use marijuana for kids that have seizures, and that shouldn't be illegal here. If you've ever seen somebody have a seizure. In college, I was a paramedic, and we transported a gal one time from Grady all the way down to Milledgeville, and she was having a seizure the whole way, and it scared the hell out of me. If that could be stopped with cannabis, then I'd say legalize it. As far as legalizing for recreational use, I don't think that's a good idea. I don't think the folks in Colorado think it's a real good idea anymore either. And it just leads to things that are worse. I've got a nephew right now who's playing with this stuff. It makes me sick. Because I know he's going to graduate to something else or tomorrow. So, no, I would not be for legalizing.
Thank you. So, Mr. Green, first, same question for you. Would you support reforms of the drug war? Specifically, would you prefer that cannabis is legalized so you can allocate finite police resources to more pertinent matters?
Well, my personal opinion, we all know that marijuana is a gateway drug for a lot of other things. Legalizing it, being in law enforcement, I would certainly say no. I would certainly say no. Medical reasons, I'm not an expert in it, but certain agents of marijuana is taken out for those kids that need that drug. And I couldn't say that shouldn't be. I believe that should. But from a law enforcement perspective, people riding around, car smoked up, you know, for those in this age group that know Cheech and Chong, that's not a good thing. I mean, it's just not a good thing if you can't have it. But seriously, let me say this. There needs to be some type of reform for those lesser crimes. There needs to be some type of reform. Not to let it go, but we're gonna have to do something to help the capacity and the population of that jail. If the jail is full of people that have simple possession, and you know, we got a floor of people with those minor possessions, we have to learn what to do. I mean, we have to get involved in another way to do something for this criminal justice system. But there should be criminal justice reform, and that's one of the issues we need to focus on.
Mr. Green, what are your views on inmate rehabilitation versus harsher punishments?
I think they go hand in hand. I mean, I really do. The jail cannot be Club Med. The DeKalb County Jail now, inmates can order chicken fingers, buffalo wings. I mean, they actually have a menu. As a trooper in Metro Atlanta, I've had inmates that ask me, can I take them to the Fulton County Jail? They did not want to go to a pretrial downtown Atlanta. That's an issue. I don't believe that people in jail should have the liberty to get their dentures done and get all of these medical procedures and get free schooling, and hardworking people going to work every day, putting in 40 hours plus a week, can't do it. That jail should not be a camp. It should not be a day camp. You should work. I believe you should turn those televisions off. If you don't want to work, we'll shut you up in that cell. But all in the same breath, there should be programs in that jail. You should be able to offer the inmates things that are going to help them and hopefully keep them out of the jail. But the people that are returning into jail, they've made a choice to go out and commit crimes again. And real quickly, Sergeant at City of Atlanta, allowed by smash and grabs, that sergeant says they arrest those guys. And while they're out on bond, they're getting arrested again. They've made a concerted decision to continue to do that. Those guys need to be out on the side of the road working.
Mr. Power, same question for you. What are your views on inmate rehabilitation versus harsher punishments?
I think the less violent crimes should be addressed in a manner where we don't have to lock them up. I have no problem putting them out on the side of the road picking up trash. We've got plenty of areas where we need to pick up trash in this town. the violent guys, we need to keep them in jail, though. We need to make some room. Whether the number's 20,000 or 100,000, we need to pick these guys up. And if we have to make some room by letting some people out, we'll let the less violent, the non-violent people out and monitor them closely. And, you know, we're just going to have to have our priorities. And we may have to add on to the jail. I know nobody wants to hear that. That's not going to be a cheap thing. But right now it's costing us $10 million a year to keep prisoners, to pay other jurisdictions, keep prisoners outside the jail. That's not a good solution.
Mr. Coward, this new question is for you. In what situations would SWAT raids be appropriate? Should they be used to serve search warrants, no knock, and otherwise?
In certain situations, you're going after somebody with a search warrant that you know is violent. In that situation, you need to send somebody with more firepower. I personally donated a armored personnel carrier to Gwinnett County just for that, because they didn't have anything when they had a bad situation. And they used it a number of times, and it's probably saved a number of lives, including the bad guys. The first time they used it, the guy was telling, they had him on the phone, and he was saying, "I'm not coming out, I'm going to take a few of you with me." And they rolled the tank off into his front yard, and he was on the phone with the hostage negotiator, and he said, "You brought a tank?" And 5 minutes later, he gave up, because he knew he was going to leave this world by himself. So sometimes you gotta bring some more firepower. It works.
Mr. Green, a question for you. In what situations would SWAT raids be appropriate? Should they be used to serve search warrants, no knock, and otherwise?
SWAT should, and is normally called out when that situation dictates a higher level of tactical experience and training than your road officers. And that's varying depending on what jurisdiction you're in and what county you're in. No agency is going to send in SWAT for a normal situation that two patrol officers can perform. SWAT should be a high and aggravated nature before you even call them out. That's what they're there for. And the level of expertise would vary around Metro Atlanta and even outside as to the ability of their agency and their officers, which has a lot to do with their training. But normally to answer that question, SWAT should only be called out when no road officers and no road deputies and no troopers out there on the road is something higher than their normal ability. Thank you.
Mr. Green, do you believe the war on drugs is a success, yes or no? And please explain why.
No. No, the war on drugs is not a success. Why? People are dying every day. Drugs are coming up and down this interstate each and every day. Pretty general question, but the war is not being won. Drugs coming over from Cuba, drugs being produced in this state, grow houses. I think our technology is going to have to advance. We're inundated from drugs coming across the border. It's very difficult with the amount of personnel to really focus as much as that particular problem dictates. It's an issue. It's going to continue to be an issue until we put a lot more focus on it. That's why we have to form relationships. The sheriff's department has to work along with the state patrol. State patrol have to, you know, partner up with the sheriff's department. And we all have to work with the federal government to try to slow it down. Those guys outnumber us. It's hard to stop something when, you know, the drug lords have more money. I mean, they can give up hundreds of millions of dollars. It's not going to stop them. They got that money stashed in a hole. So that's a very difficult situation that we're just going to have to try to get better at.
Same question for you, Mr. Coward. Do you believe the war on drugs is a success? Yes or no? And please explain why.
Well, it's obvious that it's not a success. I think the problem is at home. We're not raising our children. I don't have any, so I'm not an expert on that. But people are not raising their kids like we were raised when we were young. If you look at the intelligence level of your average Bernie Sanders supporter, you can tell there's a lot of drugs out there. But we're certainly not winning it. But, you know, we're just going to have to work together and do better at raising our children, because we're not winning. And it doesn't matter how much money you spend on it. We can turn this place into a police state like the Soviet Union, and you're not going to win.
Questions for Mr. Coward. Comment on police abuse and brutality occurring elsewhere in the country. For example, the issue with Derrick Gardner. How will you prevent and train Fulton officers to exercise restraint when appropriate?
Well, when you have somebody in custody, once they're arrested, their safety is now your responsibility. We've seen, everybody's got YouTube, we've all seen videos all over the country. The situation in Ferguson, Missouri, though, I think that officer was justified in what he did. And some of the other officers, you know, there has been some brutality. But here in Fulton County, we don't have too much of that. We've got some really good officers here. But it goes back to training. And you really got to teach them from the beginning that they're the safety of your arrestee is now your responsibility, and you can't just lock them in a situation where they're going to die. You can't keep tasing them. You can't. Sometimes they end up getting in situations where they can't breathe. They get so many people on top of them trying to arrest them, and it's just you just gotta. Concentrate on training.
Thank you. Mr. Green, same question for you. Please comment on police abuse and brutality occurring elsewhere in the country. For example, Derrick Gardner. How will you prevent and train Fulton officers to exercise restraint when appropriate?
Big problem in law enforcement right now. Law enforcement has a black eye. I can sit here and based on my experience and working in Metro Atlanta and having been around some of those situations. Again, everything's boiling down to the caliber of people that you have. I mean, it boils down to vetting and getting the very best officer or cadet, sheriff, trainee that you can get, and training. Training is paramount. But a large part of that problem is that law enforcement now is, it's in a chokehold because it's very difficult to get qualified people with, you know, with the salaries that you're paying these guys. I mean, I'm hearing guys telling me, the only reason I'm doing this is because I don't, you know, I can't find another job. You know, I think the gentleman back here said something about being a servant. To be a law enforcement official, you have to have a servant's heart. You can't come into this with an authoritarian heart. So you have to get good people, and you have to train them. But that's very slim pickings based on the salary that the average law enforcement officer in Georgia makes. You know, it's very hard to raise a family off of $30,000. And just imagine what you have to choose from at that salary. And when you get those guys on the road, it's a train wreck waiting to happen. And that's what we're seeing. We're seeing guys that couldn't have, that probably wouldn't be working here if they could do something else. Thank you.
This question's for you. If part of a sheriff's job is to serve warrants, how would you make sure warrants are served in a timely fashion? Would you prioritize them in any way?
Of course. All warrants are important because those people need to face the judicial system. But you want your violent offenders off the road. Those are the people that are causing havoc to the citizens. So you have to prioritize those higher risk warrants and those people, those more dangerous people. I mean, it's obvious. You don't want the most dangerous people walking up and down our streets and riding along in our counties. So you definitely prioritize it, but every warrant is important. But again, sheriff, you have to have the personnel, you know, to take on that challenge. Mr. Cowder said Fulton County has 3 cars on the road. That's impossible for a county this size. 10 cars on the road is impossible for a county this size, even with the other jurisdictions. But you definitely want the violent offenders off the road and out off of our streets. Thank you.
Mr. Carroll, same question for you. If part of a sheriff's job is to serve warrants, how would you make sure warrants are served in a timely fashion? Would you prioritize them in any way?
I agree with everything he just said. The only thing I would change is we got to get a lot more guys on the street serving warrants. That's the only way we're going to clear them. And 2 or 3 cars is not going to do it. Every day, you're going to be building a bigger and bigger backlog. And there's no way to do it. We need 50 cars on the road. And the Democrats are not going to do that. One of us will.
This question's for you. How would you combat the current trend to give up some constitutional principles of protection in order to receive federal funding for programs such as road improvements or more sophisticated equipment for law enforcement?
I wouldn't take the money to violate the Constitution on any case.
Mr. Green, same question for you. How would you combat the current trend to give up some constitutional principles or protection in order to receive federal funding for programs such as road improvements or more sophisticated equipment for law enforcement?
Pretty much the same thing. You never usurp your constitutional rights, no inalienable rights written by a forefather, and I stand on that wholeheartedly. Thank you.
What precautions would you take to prevent a terrorist attack like the one in Brussels? How would you work with federal agencies while respecting civil liberties?
Folks, terrorism isn't just a Fulton County problem or a Georgia problem or international or a national Texas problem. It's a total network. We're not going to stop terrorism individually. I mean, it's going to have to be a team effort. We speak terrorism generally, but You know, we have homegrown terrorism, and it's almost impossible. But we have to utilize the technologies and utilize the relationships to try to combat it as much as possible. But that's a very difficult thing, and I think it's something that's continuing to grow and grow and grow. And if we don't get a foothold on it, we're going to see some of those things here. And having experienced it 2 years in Afghanistan, terrorism is terrorism. The dovetail strikes terrorism. And I pray to God that we won't ever see anything to that level of destruction that we saw in Brussels here recently. Thank you.
Mr. Coward, what precautions would you take to prevent a terrorist attack like the one in Brussels? How would you work with federal agencies while respecting civil liberties?
The situation that happened in Brussels, I think we've been lucky here. We haven't had, at least in Atlanta, anything like that. But I think it's a matter of time. We're going to be facing something like that one day. The difference between us and the Europeans is we're all allowed to defend ourselves with guns and carry them. Some of those people could have been saved in Brussels if some of the citizens were armed. It's sad because the Belgians make some beautiful guns. They're just not allowed to have them. But we're going to have to defend ourselves. The federal government's not going to do it. Bottom line.
In the interest of time, I have three more questions, and we'll go through those, and then we'll take a break of all these questions, and just want to let you know, so please stay tuned. We have three more. Next question is for you, Mr. Coward. Do you support the, quote, illegal, unquote, codified use of no-knock search warrants, which are primarily used against blacks and poor whites?
I think there are certain situations that you have to use a no-knock warrant. I don't like to see it widespread, but sometimes you can't let the bad guys know you're coming. We haven't had too many problems with it being abused. We've had a couple of times where they had the wrong address and the situation turned out to be pretty tragic. That's unfortunate. But I think it's something that it is a tool that we're gonna have to keep.
So Mr. Green, same question for you. Do you support the, quote, illegal, unquote, codified use of no-knock search warrants, which are primarily used against blacks and poor whites?
No-knock warrants are necessary for two reasons. Number one is officer safety, and the other is to prevent those people in the house or building or whatever structure they're in, wherever they are, from getting rid of whatever drugs or whatever they, you know, that they can. But no-knock warrants are necessary. No-knock warrants are necessary. We've had officers killed in this county that didn't go in on no-knock warrants. We have to protect our officers, but to back even before that, when you go and get a warrant, your intel has to be correct. You just can't be out here running around like a bunch of cowboys. And again, folks, a lot of the problems we're having is because of the lack of training, a lack of integrity, a lack of oversight in those departments. And again, having dealt with that, having served warrants, having written warrants, you have to know what you're doing. And you can't allow just some task force from some agency, whether it be Fulton County or Cobb County, to go out and just, running roughshod through the county because they can. There has to be some type of moral fiber and integrity in what you're doing. And that's one of the problems with the no-knock warrants. Thank you.
Mr. Green, the next question is for you. Sheriff Jackson recently reduced his budget by approximately 10%. Given your budget, would you be
Given your budget would be about $100 million, do you see any potential savings for the taxpayer?
Folks, law enforcement is a necessary draw from our tax dollars. It's incumbent upon that sheriff to use it wisely. Now the responsibility of that sheriff and what he has to do plays a big role. But I believe a Republican sheriff will have a little bit better insight on spending those funds. But when you're protecting lives and doing the job that you have to do, law enforcement is very expensive. From putting a person through training, to equipping them, buying cars, ammo, and running facilities, this is a very costly but necessary profession and a necessary entity. And we just have to decide what's more important. If we cut back on the tax dollars, it's going to directly reflect what we're getting from public service. Our public service will dramatically be lower. But being the law enforcement officer that I've been over the years, there are other ways that that we would not have to draw so much from the taxpayer dollars. I think a lot of those dollars should come from the drug guys running up and down the interstates. I think we should draw more from that. But there's no getting away from the cost of safety, whether it be local or whether it be militaristic. We have to have dollars to protect ourselves, and we're gonna have to decide what's more important. Having a well-trained, well-equipped officer out there or a half-trained, lowly paid equipped officer out there. Thank you.
Mr. Coward, same question for you. Sheriff Jackson recently reduced his budget by approximately 10%. Given your budget would be about $100 million, do you see any potential savings for the taxpayers?
I agree with Mr. Green. I saw that in the budget. I find it kind of interesting for a couple of reasons. We need some new equipment in the sheriff's department. We need new radios in the cars. Our communications are not very good with other jurisdictions, computers. Friend of mine was down at the sheriff's department the other day getting some kind of paperwork, and they went to four different computers before they found one that had a working print. I don't see how you can cut your own budget that much when you need that money for so many other things. I think it's great that he cut his own budget. And that's admirable on one hand, but I think they could have used the money. I don't like, a lot of agencies get around the end of the year, and if they have any money left over, they go on a spending spree. I've never liked that. But there's this attitude that if you don't spend it, then they're going to take it out of your budget next year. I would have rather seen Sheriff Jackson return the money for 2015 and then 2016 still have the money in the budget to use. Because we're running into some things, some pretty big ticket items we're going to need. And all Fulton County's going to do with the money, if you give it back to them, they're just going to waste it on something else. They're not going to give it back to us, that's for sure. So don't expect a windfall on your taxes.
Gentlemen, this is the last question for this evening. I'll ask a question, and then I'll ask you to come up and give your closing statements for the evening. Mr. Coward, what are your opinions on Atlanta's warrant amnesty program? Can you reduce the backlog by reducing the penalties of nonviolent offenses?
It may be a good idea. If the backlog is as big as what I heard it was, I just think that number's unsurmountable. Back when I was a deputy sheriff, it was 12 to 15,000, and I thought that number was huge. And if it's as high as what I heard, I just don't see how we're gonna be able to get through that and not build it on the jail. We're gonna need to make some room. And that's gonna be a tough question. But if you're gonna let it, if you're gonna lessen the penalties on anybody, it should be the non-violent ones.
Mr. Green, same question. What are your opinions on Atlanta's warrant amnesty program? Can you reduce the backlog by reducing the penalties of nonviolent offenses?
I think it's a great idea. You know, law enforcement isn't, it's never meant to be a money or revenue generating entity. And I don't think law or our constitution mean to step on the citizen's neck. People make mistakes, okay? I'd much rather have an amnesty program in effect that allows those hardworking, a lot of these people are hardworking, that have made a mistake, that struggling to raise their family and take care of their family, but they had to do an either or. So they don't have the money, and this isn't every case, but law enforcement still should have compassion. Our judicial system still should have compassion for those lesser offenses. So I think it's an excellent idea, and I wish it would be a year round, you know, at least give them at least 6 months to do it, to come forward, okay? So they can continue to do what they're doing. The violent offenders, no amnesty. You know, you should pay the price. They're gonna come get you. We can't, you know, if it's a violent offense, there should be no passes. But some of the violent, less violent offenses, yes. Let's have that program and let's run it to help the people.
John. I know I'm out of order, but this is of utmost importance. I have to get some clarity. I asked a question about no-knock search warrants. People like Catherine Bernard, myself, Ted Metz, fought the Georgia legislature
from legalizing no-knock search warrants because, as a matter of law, they are already illegal. Both of you said you support the Constitution. And I'm assuming that is the Georgia Constitution and the United States Constitution. And the only reason no-knock search warrants are used in Georgia is because of federal precedents. So I'm gonna ask my question again. Are you going to continue to support the illegal use, as a matter of Georgia law, of no-knock search warrants?
Thank you, Mr. Grayson. Yes, that is out of order, but I'll pass it on to the gentleman when you're ready to respond to that question more precisely. Mr. Coward?
I haven't thought about this until now. I heard the question when he asked no-knock warrants, like, I don't know what I thought you meant, looking for somebody. A search warrant? That's kind of a gray area. I probably would not use that. Because if you're looking for substance, it's probably still going to be there. If you're there to arrest somebody who's wanted and they're dangerous and they're armed, then I would be okay using it. But if you're just looking for contraband, there's only so much they can flush down the toilet.
Mr. Rand, are you willing to respond?
Yes, sir. Sir, a search warrant is just that. You have to knock on the door, you have to identify yourself. That's a search warrant. A no-knock warrant is different. A no-knock warrant has extenuating circumstances and officers safely involved. Those are two type warrants. When you go to the judge and you write the warrant, that judge authorizes that. That narrative explains that. A no-knock warrant, somebody's in there dangerous, and we're going in there to get it. A search warrant, somebody has probable cause, and they've written it up in the narrative to believe that whatever that warrant that has been signed off on, that for whatever they're searching for, whether it be an individual, drugs, guns, or whatever, a grow house or whatever, you have a search warrant to legally go inside that house. No knock warrants different from a search warrant. Thank you.
Thank you, gentlemen. In the interest of time, I'm going to ask you each to make your closing statement. I ask that you be limited to 2 minutes, please. Mr. Cowherd first.
I really appreciate y'all coming out today. I need your vote. My capable opponent is also very qualified. If you can't stomach vote for me, please vote for him.
Folks, there's a problem in law enforcement. We see it on the news every night. No morals, no integrity, authoritarianism. We need a Fulton County sheriff that has integrity, that has morals, and most importantly, that has the experience. The majority of my experience has been in Fulton County and in Metro Atlanta, via through the Georgia State Patrol, the Fulton County Sheriff's Department, the Coweta County Sheriff's Department, and the Fulton County School Police. I have a vested interest in this county. I live here. My kids graduated from school here. We need a leader, a servant, somebody that's going to step out front and somebody that's not going to be afraid to stand in the midst of the federal government when they're infringing on our constitutional right. So we need a leader that's going to stand, even if it's the city of Atlanta or any other jurisdiction, somebody that has the knowledge and the experience to know what law enforcement looks like. This isn't a job to be played with, and this is not a position, a sheriff position. For too long, it's been just a retirement holding post. In law enforcement, we call it ROD, R-O-D. Retired on duty. Our current sheriff is retired on duty. It's time out for that. The apathy for this position is time out for that. This is a constitutionally mandated position. The highest law enforcement official in the county. You shouldn't wear that hat if you do not have the experience, if you do not have the know-how. You shouldn't step up to the bat. You shouldn't step up to the plate, I'm sorry, if you don't have it. This position demands it. And it's a travesty to what has happened in this county over the last 25 plus years. Thank you again. Please vote for me.
Thank you. A round of applause for both gentlemen. So take us away is going to be Nate Porter, our CEO of the Fulton Republican Assembly.
Thank you. Once again, I just want to say a big thank you to both you guys. I've personally run for office before Roswell City Council. It takes a lot of guts to get up there and just throw your name out there. Whether you're running for sheriff, whether you're running for state house, whether you're running for city council, it does take a lot out of you, and it takes a lot of time, and it's all volunteer, especially if you don't get elected. So once again, please give it up for these guys. Fulton County, because it's very democratic. So hopefully we can change that with these upcoming elections here. Also, please make sure you guys thank the servers, this venue, just so you guys know, it's not like we own this place. It's not like this is ours. This is obviously a borrowed space. So make sure that you guys tip graciously. Make sure you guys thank the servers. Make sure you show your appreciation for them allowing us to be here. The other thing I'd like you guys to just keep in mind is those petitions. If you guys can just funnel those back
to Denise. She's got her hand up there in the back if you guys don't see her. Get them filled out, get them signed in. Other than that, I just want to thank everybody for taking the time out of your day. I know, you know, government and running for office and all that's not necessarily the most exciting thing in the world to do, but it's very important because it affects our everyday lives, literally everything that's there. So with that said, I was just given the 30 seconds, so I appreciate it again.